Welcome you all to my video sessions on compression members in steel structures. So far I have discussed what are the compression members, how to calculate the design compressive strength in the columns. We have categorized these compression members in two types. Here members carrying axial compressive loads will be in the columns as well as in struts. So in my earlier sessions I have covered the design concepts related to the columns. So today I will be moving on how to calculate the design compressive strength and the design concepts to be followed for these struts. Basically these struts are the inclined members in a building structure. So here in the figure a building frame is here we have an RC frame where these vertical members are the columns, and here in a roof truss the elements which are inclined here, or these are the members of a roof truss where this inclined member is called as a strut. So this strut is a axial load carrying member, axial compression load carrying member, as well as we have a bracing system in a building where these inclined braces or diagonal bracings are called as a compression members. To follow the design concept, we look into the CODEL procedure here. So from IS 800 2007, so clause number 7.5, it is basically meant for angle struts. So we have two forms of loading pattern in angle struts. So basically we refer angle section for the struts. So if the angles are having a two patterns, one we have a concentric loading and one we have eccentric loading. Here for concentric loading, so here for a single angle concentrically loaded in the compression, the design to be followed or to be evaluated is using equation 7.1.2 as what we have used earlier for our columns. This clause we have referred earlier for the columns. So if you look into this clause 7.1.2, so here this is a clause 7.1.2. so 7.1.2 design compressive strength is given by this formula P which is less than PD. So we have already discussed these formulas in my earlier problems for the columns. So here you refer this clause for angle struts, single angle struts which are concentrically loaded. Next we have one more pattern which is eccentrically loaded or loaded through one leg. So looking into this figure, this is a angle section connected to a gusset where one leg is been connected or has been connected to a gusset. So here this loading will be on one of its leg, so either in this which is not connected outstanding leg or where when it is connected, so loading will be on either of these legs. So this type of loading is a eccentrically loading. So what code says here for the that eccentrically loading or loaded through one leg, you have to refer clause number 7.5.1.2 where you need to find effective equivalent slenderness ratio, because we have a flexural torsional buckling strength here. Because here in columns we had purely a flexural buckling, but here we have combined failure or combination of both the failure patterns, which is a flexural torsional buckling. So for these eccentrically loaded columns, angle sections, we need to find flexural torsional buckling strength of single angle using this equivalent slenderness ratio, using this formula from clause number 7.5.1.2, wherein lambda I equals to square root of k1 plus k2 lambda vv square plus k1 lambda phi square, where these constants k1, k2 and k3 depends on the end conditions as given in table number 12. So here constants k1, k2 and k3 depends on the end conditions, where the end conditions such as the bolts at each end connection. So bolts at each end connections means, so here this angle leg has been connected to a gusset by a single bolt. So this is our end condition. Or sometimes the angle sections are connected with more than two bolts. This is also one condition. So here for these connections, if you have the constants k1, k2, k3, if you have more number of bolts, more than two bolts, whether it is fixed or hinged. So condition may be a fixed or hinged. Fixed means then if it is welded, fixed, or if it is simply connected, it is a hinged connection. Then we have to use accordingly these constants k1, k2, k3. Okay. If you have a single bolt, the connection fixity, whether it is fixed or hinged, accordingly choose the constants k1, k2, k3. So likewise, you need to calculate this equivalent slenderness ratio. And remaining these formulas like lambda vv square is calculated using this expression, and lambda psi is used calculated using this expression. So we will try to understand these formulae while solving our example. Okay. Next we will look into a effective length. Here L will be a center to center length of the supporting member, where small l. So this is our effective length. So effective length, according to this clause, here from 7.5.2 to 7.5.3. So to know the effective length here, you refer the clause 7.5.2.1 to 7.5.3. So we have effective length here. So I have briefly extracted values from these clauses, so in the form of table here. So effective length of studs, we have a types here. So type, if it is a continuous angle section where we find these continuous members in trusses, top chord members, or we will find this in electric poles or electric towers, the angles which are continuous connections. So where we have a single angle or a double angles, in the form of single or double angles. So for that, effective length is based here. So here the values are the k factors, effective length factors. Okay. So k multiplied by l to a capital L gives me the effective length, where k has to be chosen accordingly using this clause or following this IS code procedure. So k factor 0.721 will be for the buckling in the plane of gusset, and one will be, or a constant one will be for a buckling perpendicular to the gusset. So this is according to clause 7.2.4. So again, if I have a discontinuous type of connections, then sections where we have single angle only with one bolt, single angle connection with one bolt. So this is a discontinuous angle, which is a single angle with a single bolt. For that, we have a constant value here for buckling in plane of gusset will be 1, and buckling in perpendicular to the gusset will be 1. This is according to clause number 7.5.3. according to IS 800. Here, referring discontinuous, if you have double angles placed back to back, Again, we have 0.7 to 0.85 and 1 according to clause number 7.5.2.1. And discontinuous double angles placed back to back on same side. So these are the cases. Back to back on opposite sides would be 0.7 to 0.85. And if you have same side, again it will be 0.7 to 0.85. So these are based on the clause numbers 7.5.2.1 and clause number 7.5.2.2. So this is how we have to follow the code to find out the effective length or to know the effective length of struts. Now I will solve an example of these struts using an angle section. So I have an ISA 800 by 800 and 6 mm thickness. Its grade yield stress will be 250 newton per mm square. Is used in a truss. This is a ISA 800 angle section as a strut member, which is in roof truss. The length of the strut between the intersections. Intersections means between the connections. At each end is 3 meter. Calculate the design compressive strength of this of the strut for these three conditions. So it is connected by two bolts at each end. So an angle section here, this angle is connected by two bolts. This is an angle connected with two bolts to a gusset like this. So if the angle connected by one bolt at each end and if it is welded, okay. For these conditions we will try to solve the or calculate the design compressive strength in this angle section. Assume Fe 410 grade steel. Extract the relevant properties from steel table. So here I need to gather area of that section. So area of 100 by 100 by 6 mm angle section, equal angle section, it is 1167 mm square. Next to take minimum radius of gyration here, Rv equals to 19.5. So here in angle section, we have Rv, this is the minimum axis. As in I sections where we have used for the columns, where we had a radius of gyration in both the axis for this y axis and for the z axis, for minor axis and for minor major axis. But in this case we are using Rv as a minimum radius of gyration here. Next step, we have to find the effective length of single angle strut. Effective length of single angle strut according to clause number 7.2.4, it is 0.7 to 1. It is a single angle strut. It is loaded eccentrically. So effective length will be 0.7 to 1 L. So here, this clause, so single angle in a truss, it is continuous type. So we have 0.7 to 1. So clause number 7.24 gives me this condition. So here I choose 1 L, which is 3 meter. So here it is 3 meter length. So K times L, so K is 1 here, L will be 3 meter, so K times L gives me 3 meter. Now for this first condition, if it is connected by two bolts at each end, okay, so considering the ends to be fixed, so according to table number 12, we have two end conditions, fixed and hinged. So first we will try to solve for fixed and I will take these constants 0.2, 0.35 and 20. I will try to solve for hinged and using these constants 0.7, 0.65. Okay. So if equivalent slenderness ratio for the fixed condition, we have the formula from clause number 7.5.1.2, which is given by this formula. So here the lambda v square and lambda phi square are found using this expression, where lambda vv equals to L by rvv, where rvv is the minimum radius of gyration, epsilon times square root of pi square into E divided by 250. So here L will be, small L will be a 3000 mm is a span. RVV is a minimum radius of gyration 19.5. Epsilon is 1 here. So epsilon is calculated by this formula here. Square root of 250 divided by Fi equals to 1. So here we have used 1. Pi square, where E is a Young's modulus of steel, 2 times 10 raised to 5 Newton mm square divided by 250. It gives me 1.731. So again we have lambda of y, where b1 plus b2 are the dimensions of these legs. Here this is b1, this is b2. So 100 plus 100 divided by 2 times thickness. Thickness will be here, thickness will be 6 mm. So 2 times t. Epsilon is 1, pi square 2 times into 10 raised to 5, that is Young's modulus of steel, divided by 250 into 2 times 6 mm thickness. So that gives me the value of 0.1875. So for a fixed condition, k1 values are 0.2, k2 0.35 and k3 20, and for hinged we have k1 0.7, 0.6, 0.5. So here in the red ink I have written these k constant values, and in black ink I have written these constant values for fixed condition. So try to understand here. I will try to solve it once using fixed condition, where I have n circled here with red ink, so that it is understood the values what we used are for the hinged condition. So we have both the values here simultaneously. So lambda E equals to, using that formula, I have lambda E equivalent slenderness ratio as 1.397, and for hinged condition I have 1.635. After getting this, use find the design compressive stress FCD using the clause 7.1.2. So therefore we know this formula earlier from our design of columns. This is the formula here. So here you have to get this lambda E. So already we have calculated lambda E. So use this value here and substitute, where phi is also a known. So here instead of that lambda Y and Z, you use equivalent value here. So the only change you find here in this formula, this equivalent slenderness ratio. Wherever there is equivalent slenderness ratio, input that value in this formulas. And one more thing to be remembered here, alpha value will be 0.49, because for angle sections alpha, that is imperfection factor, will be 0.49, because it, for angle sections it is the buckling class curve will be C. So this is C here for buckling class section. So from IS 800 table number 10 gives a buckling class of cross sections. For angle sections here, channel, angle, T or solid sections, if you have angle section here, the buckling class will be C. Earlier for the columns we have referred I sections, we have preferred I sections, then we had buckling class A, B or C, or A, B, C, D. Okay, so accordingly you have to choose the buckling class here for different sections. So for angle section here, the buckling class is C, then the alpha will be 0.49, imperfection factor. So after inputting all those values, I find FCD as 79.55 for fixed condition, and red ink gives me for the hinged condition, where the FCD value is 62.4. So their design compressive strength is given by A times FCD, where A is the area of the section, and FCD for hinged fixed condition, input the value here, you will get the design compressive strength as 92, and for hinged condition the design compressive strength will be 72. This was for the condition for two bolts. The angle is connected with two bolts. What if the angle is connected with one bolt? Then the procedure according to table number 12, the values will be same here. These lambda VV value and lambda phi values will be same. Only thing, the conditions will vary here. For a single bolt fixed condition, we have these constants as 0.75, 0.35, 20 year, and for hinge we have 1.25, 0.5 and 60. These are the only things which are varied. So input all those values. Similarly, how did you find from the previous step? I find FCD as 65.76 for hinge fixed condition and 37.79 for hinge condition. So the design compressive strength will be 76.75 for fixed condition and 44.11 for hinged condition. So when we compare, if you have two bolts, the design compressive strength for fixed condition it is 92 and for hinged condition it was 67. For single bolt, design compressive strength is 75 and for hinged condition it is 44, which is lesser value for a single bolt. For welded condition, it will be same as the strength of what we have found for the two bolts. So it will be 92.83 kilonewton. This is how we will solve or we will follow the concept finding the design compressive strength for angle struts. Okay. So my next video session, I will try to solve some more examples using angle struts, where we'll try to understand the design concepts of these compression members. Thank you.